Hello, this is Austin Hetzler, the pastor of Christ the Rock Church of Elyria, Ohio. We at Christ the Rock are humbled and grateful to get to be a part of your sanctification today as you watch or listen to this sermon. But at the same time, we want to encourage you to be a member of a good local church and not to allow online sermons to replace the local church and to benefit from the life of that church and to give your spiritual gifts back to that church. Having said that, our website is www.christrockchurch.com. If you go there, you can find sermons, blogs, and other resources, as well as our location and service times. You can also listen to the sermons on Bible Thumping Wingnut, Podbean, iTunes, Google Play Music, iHeartRadio, and other podcast catchers. We also invite and encourage you to subscribe to our YouTube station. You can look it up, or you can use the link to it that's found on our website. I, along with a membership of Christ the Rock Church, sincerely pray that this sermon will be a blessing. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to come together again as your people and learn more of the critical elements of the Christian message that is to be proclaimed on the street corner to the masses by a single man, that is to be proclaimed from the pulpit in every local church, and that is to be proclaimed and declared by every single Christian, both to other Christians and to the lost as well. Lord, this is the beating heart of the Christian faith. I pray that you would give us ears to hear it, discern its rhythms, and be faithful to this message. We praise you and we thank you for all these things. We pray for a movement of the Spirit, without which this is a vain enterprise. We thank you for this, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, last week, if you recall, we started a series titled The Anatomy of Preaching, and there we likened the various aspects of a sermon to various organs in a body. And these organs considered were preaching as dogmatic declaration, preaching as exegesis of Scripture, and preaching as solemn testimony. And as we said, all the aspects of preaching that we're going to be considering here are essential. There are no vestigial organs, as they call them. Nothing, no elements, no components that can be set aside. All must be present, all must be in operation in the way that they are to be, otherwise the whole is not healthy. And the whole does not glorify God by expounding Christ as it ought to. However, that is not to say that all aspects of preaching are the same, nor that they play the same role, nor even that they are equally vital. So to continue to make that analogy, then, not everything is the heart and not everything is the brain. If we had to identify elements along this line that would amount to organs that were the most vital, we could choose at least two of the three proceeding to fit that bill. And these are preaching that affirms the sovereignty of God, preaching that is resurrection focused, and preaching that extols Christ and Him crucified. As you may have guessed, these are the subjects of our study today. And preaching, again, that lacks any or all of these is not biblical preaching, as we will, I hope, well establish. But before we get there, we need to note again as we begin is that perhaps the difference between preaching outside of the church and preaching inside of the church is nowhere as dramatic as when considering the role that at least the sovereignty of God and the resurrection play. Outside of the church, we preach entrance to the kingdom because we are preaching to people who are not in the kingdom. They are not born again. They do not belong to the Lord. An entrance to the kingdom cannot be expounded without preaching the sovereignty of God and the resurrection. Therefore, any sermon ever preached to unbelievers has got to have these elements in it and to maximum degree. Inside the church, though, we preach entrance to the kingdom because we don't know who's here. We know from Scripture that there will always be in the visible church unbelievers present as well. We don't assume the salvation status of people. But we also preach living in the kingdom because primarily in a Bible-preaching church, you will have believers. They are in Christ's kingdom. They need to know how to behave well in Christ's kingdom. And we achieve this end by preaching the whole counsel of God. And we achieve this by preaching through Scripture verse by verse, so that we do not miss any of the essential elements of the Christian life. So for this reason, whatever our text emphasizes, we emphasize. And since we are simply exegeting it, whatever it doesn't emphasize, we also don't emphasize. And so if the resurrection is not present in the text directly, nor a strong mention of God's sovereignty, these things ought to be present to some degree in the preaching, but they will understandably not be as prominent. But notice that I excluded from this principle the element of preaching that extols Christ and Him crucified. Continuing to make the anatomical, analogical connection, we need to acknowledge here that human beings are not merely matter and motion. They're not only brains and hearts and lungs and the like. We also have souls. And if you were to identify any single element of preaching that we are raising here and discussing as the soul of a sermon, it would without question be preaching that extols Christ and Him crucified. This is, in fact, not only an essential element of biblical preaching, it is the chief end of it as well. Now, there are texts that some would say don't actually involve Christ directly, and so it is okay to leave Him out of these things. Old Testament narratives are an example of this. Creation accounts are another. Lessons on mere morality. But thinking down this path, what was the chief end of all the Old Testament narratives and God's preservation of His people? Was He not preserving them that He might deliver from them a Messiah? Is He not greater than every character being expounded? Is He not the fulfillment of every lesson that they teach? Is He not the focal point of the entirety of the Old Covenant? So how can you preach that without Him? And by which person of the Trinity did the Father create, if we're talking about creation narratives? John 1, Hebrews 1, Colossians 1, many other places. It was by the second person of the Trinity who incarnate is Christ. So you can't do that without Him either. And what is a lesson on mere morality derived from the biblical text, say from some story in the life of David or another Old Testament figure? Well, that would be heresy, actually, because as a category, we don't allow for this. We don't have mere morality. Mere morality is be better. Christianity is be born again. That is the message of Satan. It's the same message as the Pharisees, and you can preach that message from Old Testament narratives, but you have completely missed the point. How did the Old Testament saints behave that way? Well, they behaved that way because they were indwelt by the Holy Spirit of God as they looked forward to the sacrifice that Christ would give on their behalf. And nobody with a biblical hermeneutic thinks those ways. Only one who parses the parts but has entirely failed to grasp the paradigm itself. Every preacher, both of the public and the private kind, fails to some degree in every sermon. I certainly do. There is a part of the worship service that is perfect, but that's not the preaching, it's the scripture reading. That's the part that is inerrant. But as a categorical error, Christless sermons can never, ever happen. And before we're through, we'll expand upon the reasons for this. And with these introductory thoughts said, let's turn again to our text, and then we will derive from it our points. Acts 2:14 through 42. But Peter, taking his stand with the 11, raised his voice and declared to them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and give heed to my words, for these men are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only the third hour of the day. But this is what was spoken of through the prophet Joel. And it shall be in the last days, God says, that I will pour forth of my spirit on all mankind, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even on my bondslaves, both men and women, I will in those days pour forth of my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will grant wonders in the sky above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun will be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and glorious day of the Lord shall come. And it shall be that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Men of Israel, listen to these words. Jesus the Nazarene, a man attested to you by God with miracles and wonders and signs which God performed through him in your midst, just as you yourselves know, this man, delivered over by the predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God, you nailed to a cross by the hands of godless men and put him to death. But God raised him up again, putting an end to the agony of death, since it was impossible for him to be held in its power. For David says of him, I saw the Lord always in my presence, for he is at my right hand, so that I will not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad and my tongue exalted. Moreover, my flesh also will live in hope, because you will not abandon my soul to Hades, nor allow your Holy One to undergo decay. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. Brethren, I may confidently say to you, regarding the patriarch David, that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. And so, because he was a prophet and knew that God had sworn to him with an oath to seat one of his descendants on his throne, he looked ahead and spoke of the resurrection of the Christ, that he was neither abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh suffer decay. This Jesus God raised up again, to which we are all witnesses. Therefore, having been exalted to the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured forth this which you both see and hear. For it was not David who ascended into heaven, but he himself says, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. Now when they heard this, they were pierced to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brethren, what shall we do? And Peter said to them, repent and each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call to himself. And with many other words, he solemnly testified and kept on exhorting them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. So then those who had received his word were baptized, and that day were added about 3,000 souls. They were continually devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to the breaking of bread and to prayer. So point number one is preaching affirms the sovereignty of God. Preaching affirms the sovereignty of God. And this is point number one again for this afternoon. It is actually the fourth in the order as we have been going through these things. Again, there will be nine in total. Now, Peter expounds the sovereignty of God in both the death and resurrection of Christ, and we'll address that shortly. But he explains to them, as we will address directly, that their very presence in the here and now, to hear his address to them, is itself, in fact, an act of God's sovereignty. And this is done by Peter through the reference to Joel's prophecy that we looked at last week. He says, the advent of that which Joel spoke of, amongst others, is happening right now in your hearing, in your observance. They, however, were surely ignorant of this before Peter revealed it to them. They thought that they were responding to a violent noise and then to the chaotic sounds of 120 people speaking simultaneously from a distance. No doubt all of them supposed themselves to have been in that general region incidentally or of some necessity or another, on their way to the market, on their way home from the market, fulfilling some vocational or familial responsibility. But in fact, they were all there by divine appointment. What drew them and kept them as a matter of nature was likely the desire to behold the spectacle, to discern some reason for this. But what actually drew and kept them was the Holy Spirit of God, that he may, through Peter's preaching, make them a spectacle to the world, be speaking Christ and him crucified, as their flesh was about to have the Spirit poured out upon it. Again, per Joel's words. Now, a form of this is always at work in the giving of the gospel. Every single time you give the gospel to somebody, it's by divine appointment, and that's true from the opposite end of this as well. Every time an unbeliever hears the gospel, it is by divine appointment. Although typically when you hear that category of divine appointment, to what is it ascribed exclusively? subscribe to when a person is converted as a result of the preaching of the gospel. We would better understand this, though, as a divine appointment unto eternal life. And that's what happened at Pentecost, and glory be to God for it. Amen. But glory be to God when we have divine appointments with unbelievers unto judgment, even when we are, per the words of Paul, an aroma of death to them. We are still so under the sovereign hand of God. God is no less in that. After all, it was God who told Jeremiah to go and give the message of salvation, and he told him it would be largely without acceptance. Same thing with Ezekiel. Yet are you going to deny that both of these men were divinely appointed to their respective tasks? Paul was inarguably divinely appointed to be at Mars Hill in the Areopagus and give the message that he gave there and leave with converts as a result of it. But he was equally responding to divine appointment when the outcome was rejection and beatings, as in Acts 22. Now this needs to be said, because many judge whether God is with us or was with us in the giving of the gospel in a particular incident on the basis of the outcome being positive. Again, if somebody's converted or if there's some other ostensible hand of providence at work bringing about potentially a positive outcome at a future time, then God has clearly been with us. God is with us in every giving of the gospel. Because God has commanded us to give the gospel to all creation without qualification of outcome. Do you recall that in the Great Commission? Give it when it's accepted. Give it when you seem to discern that something is happening in that person, or you seem to discern that there's an open door. How many open doors has God made that the person knew nothing about who was giving the gospel? And how many closed doors have been slammed in the face of people who were faithful? Many. And when the outcome is positive, we thank the Lord for his tender mercies. This is what we want, this is what we pray for. But when the outcome is negative, the unbeliever has dishonored themselves, but God has still been honored. Because there isn't a singular purpose for the giving of the gospel being the conversion of souls. There's another greater value even than that. It is the proclamation and the declaration of the glory of God, his dominion, his righteousness, his grace. They have still been proclaimed even if they have been rejected. And so clearly God is in this, guiding and directing the one who is witnessing. Furthermore, in telling his hearers that this moment has been divinely appointed, Peter gives us an example as well. Have you ever said to somebody that you're about to give the gospel to, or that you've already started to give the gospel, something along the order of, "The Lord God Almighty has sent me here right now to say this to you, that Christ was crucified for sinners and risen on the third day and seated at the right hand of the Father, and that by him you may live forever. By him you may be forgiven. By him you may escape the wrath of God." Because you should. Because it's true. And you can say along with that, according to 2 Corinthians 6:2, "Now is the acceptable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation." Sinner, if God has appointed this moment for you to hear of his salvation, who are you to refuse him? I am here by appointment. I don't know the outcome of this appointment. But I pray that you will turn to Christ and say that the outcome will be life. But as we noted at the beginning of this consideration, the sovereignty of God is not only what has brought these 3,000 to Peter, it's also being expounded in the sermon itself. God's sovereignty pervades all of this, but we'll focus on verses 22 and 23 where it is especially highlighted. "Men of Israel, listen to these words. Jesus the Nazarene, a man attested to you by God with miracles and wonders and signs which God performed through him in your midst, just as you yourselves know, this man delivered over by the" what? "Predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God." Why was Jesus betrayed by Judas? Why were those events allowed to happen that precipitated his death? Because of the predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God. And why would God allow His Holy One to be brutally murdered? That seems counterintuitive. If the favor of God rests uniquely upon Jesus, for this to be the end, and really not the end, but for this to have been allowed to happen at all? Why? Because of the predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God. And why did Jesus rise from the dead? Because it was the predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God, as expounded by David in the Scriptures, in their Scriptures. And to what ultimate end did all of this occur? And why ultimately was this the predetermined plan of God? Now, verses 34 through 36, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified, to establish the absolute dominance of King Jesus. That's why. To the glory of the Father. All of this happened according to the predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God. Now, there's a great and mostly modern debate about whether or not the sovereignty of God should be preached alongside the gospel. We don't, after all, want to offend the victims of some childhood Arminian Sunday school. We also don't want to offend the pagans who know of no God higher than themselves and are therefore incensed at the very notion that he is in fact the captain of their fate rather than them. But those considerations are in fact irrelevant. Question itself is falsely based, since without the sovereignty of God, there is no gospel. This is true of the deliverance of the Messiah. How do you get there if God is not sovereign? When all the nations that fell and rose and all the chaos from a human perspective ensued, God preserved his people and brought them back under Nehemiah, but all through the intertestamental period. They change hands, this nation rises. How do you still get Jesus? And how do you get Jesus in exactly the place and time that he was predicted to be in? According to Daniel, according to Malachi, according to Isaiah. Well, you get that happening in exactly the time and place that it was supposed to happen because God is controlling everything. And you also can't communicate the salvation of the individual sinner without the sovereignty of God to some degree. God doesn't need to be sovereign if there's some spark of life in the sinner. If there's something within them that allows them to respond to him positively and exercise faith. But God had better be sovereign if indeed the sinner is dead in the way that Scripture conveys that they are in fact dead. They have no spiritual life. They have no spiritual unction. They have no spiritual arms with which to reach out to him for salvation. And so God must intervene. He must contravene. He must breathe life into those dead bones or they will not move. He must be sovereign over that. Peter preached God's sovereignty and consider that he did so even in light of the fact that the audience that he was preaching to already accepted it largely. After all, what Jew doesn't believe that God has a chosen people? Therefore, he was obviously sovereign over their choosing. God went to Abraham, not the other way around. And yet, though they know this on some level, Peter preaches it anyways. Because while they accepted God's sovereignty, they did not understand its role in the death and the resurrection of Jesus. So for them, the category was accepted, but it was not properly applied. They were the fruit of God's sovereignty, but Christ's brutal beatings and heinous death, appearing to be chaotic to them, seemed to be the evidence of God's disapproval. For obvious reasons, if you saw that happen, you would think, that man is indeed condemned by God to die, and you would be right. But that wasn't because he lacked virtue. It wasn't because God wasn't bringing about a good end. According to Peter, God was sovereign over this in order to bring life through Christ's death. and not as a judge over Jesus to demonstrate that he was illegitimate. And for us, we need to preach the sovereignty of God, I would argue even more so than Peter did, because the category itself is not accepted in our culture. We preach to pagans who fancy themselves to be nothing more than the children of chance chaos, and we preach to Arminian acolytes who couldn't exegete their way out of a cardboard box and who largely hate the sovereignty of God because they hate the God who is sovereign. Now, with respect to this category, we do have an example from Scripture as well, but this time it's going to come from the apostle to the pagans who was Paul. Acts 17, we'll start in verse 22 and skim through to verse 31. Men of Athens, I observe that you are all very religious in all respects. For while I was passing through and examining the objects of your worship, I also found an altar with this inscription, to an unknown God. Therefore, what you worship in ignorance, this I proclaim to you, the God who made the world and all things in it. Since he is Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hands, nor is he served by human hands, as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all people life and breath and all things. And he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined by his sovereign will their appointed times and the boundaries of their habitation. In him we live and move and exist. What greater statement of God's sovereignty can you have than that? God is now declaring to men that all people everywhere should repent because he has fixed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness through a man whom he has appointed, having furnished proof to all men by raising him from the dead. Nothing is by chance, says Paul. You live, you move, you exist, you will breathe your next breath by leave of the sovereign God. And more than by his leave, it is under his direct control. So in the final analysis, we preach the sovereignty of God to both the adherents of Abrahamic religions and the pagans alike, because God is not God if God is not sovereign. God was not sovereign. He could not have brought forth Christ at exactly the appointed time, nor raised him. And he also can't save you, if not for his sovereignty, for the reasons we have already expounded. Since then, the historical realities of the gospel would be impossible without God's sovereignty, as well as individual salvation. Communicating these facts without declaring that God is sovereign is confusing and nonsensical. God's sovereignty is so fundamental to his nature and ubiquitous in Scripture that to deny or omit it over creation, salvation history, or the salvation of each and every individual is to necessarily omit much of what's written and to twist even what you do expound. Now, the reluctance in raising God's sovereignty is, again, as we alluded to earlier, largely based upon not wanting people to get tripped up on it. That misses the fact, though, that the gospel is itself fundamentally what? A stumbling block. People have to trip on it. And if they're to be converted, then it'll be God who picks them up and sets them on the narrow path. But the tripping must occur. And much of what sinners need to trip over and stumble on is that God is in control, not them, which is to say that God is God and they are not. Every sinner believes that they are sovereign. They are the kings and queens over their own little kingdoms. So every sinner needs to be disabused of this heresy if they are ever to be converted. Point number two, preaching is resurrection focused. What would it mean if Christ was never raised? Well, it would mean, among other things, that we all chose very poorly as to how to spend this particular Sunday, or indeed all our Sundays, or indeed the entirety of our lives. As Paul said, 1 Corinthians 15:17 through 19, if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless. You are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If we hope in Christ in this life only, we are of all men most to be pitied. And what then is the testimony of our faith if Christ is not raised? Well, to put it charitably, it would be the sad, vapid traditions of silly people being exported to a humanity that should rightly dismiss them. But what then is the testimony of a Christian who believes in the resurrection but does not raise it in his or her witness? Well, number one, they're telling a story that ends with a dead Jesus, and that doesn't seem like it will save anybody. And number two, they're like a boxer that has a devastating right hook but never deploys it, never uses it to win the fight. Listen to Peter again, starting in verse 22 and skimming. Men of Israel, listen to these words. Jesus the Nazarene, a man attested to you by God with miracles and wonders and signs, which God performed through him in your midst, just as you yourselves know. This man, delivered over by the predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God, you nailed to a cross by the hands of godless men and put him to death. But God raised him up again, putting an end to the agony of death, since it was impossible for him to be held in its power. Verse 32, this Jesus God raised up again, to which we are all witnesses. As I read that, I wish that photography had existed at that particular point in history and that a picture had been taken of the crowd as they hear these words, because I imagine there to have been a mushroom cloud hovering over them and for all of their eyebrows to be cinched when he said, this Jesus God raised up again, to which we are all witnesses. They just completely lost the argument. If there was to be an argument made in opposition to this, how are you going to rebut that? Now, previously, Peter had noted that they all knew that Jesus was a man not of this world only. Verse 22, men of Israel, listen to these words. Jesus the Nazarene, a man attested to you by God with miracles and wonders and signs which God performed through him in your midst, just as you yourselves know. There was never a question as to whether or not Jesus was authentic in the exercise of otherworldly power. The only question was who it came from. If you recall, he was accused of doing these things by the power of the devil. He was never accused of being a fake. So the beginning point in their knowledge of Jesus is that he did things that couldn't be accounted for as a matter of nature. And they also knew that they had nailed him to a cross by the hands of godless men and put him to death. What they did not know was that his death happened according to the predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God, for among many other reasons, to establish the necessary preconditions for his greatest miracle and wonder and sign, which was that unlike every other man and even the great patriarch David himself, he didn't stay dead. He alone conquered death, because for him alone it was impossible to be held in its power. What they also did not know until right now is why anybody would be preaching about Jesus, much less 120-somebodies, especially in the current social, political, religious context. First off, Jesus was murdered for his beliefs less than 2 months prior to this. So any sane person would have recanted their faith in him out of self-preservation, or at least they'd have the sense to keep their mouth shut about it. But they definitely wouldn't create this kind of a scene for Rome and the Sanhedrin and everybody else to see. Second, Christ is dead. Why isn't the faith that bears his name dead also? Oh, it's because he's not dead. It's because he appeared to 500 people. And upon the sight of their risen Lord, they were emboldened to risk life and death and imprisonment and everything else to proclaim and declare Christ was risen indeed. Now, what has not changed in the last 2,000 years is that the advent of Christianity post-crucifixion, producing mass conversion based upon the preaching of Christ's contemporaries, who all uniformly claim his resurrection to have happened and are so convinced that they die in service of this claim, has no natural answer. Christianity alone as a world religion is based upon a falsifiable event that occurred at a point in time. Islam is supposed to be a recovery of the gospel that was written more than 6 centuries after Christ and adopted largely a significant period of time after that. No historical event, though, that it pointed to. And it's, by the way, based upon the private revelation given to a single man. Buddhism, as another example, is supposedly the account of a man who reached nirvana, this being Siddhartha, but it wasn't recorded for 2,500 years after his death. So what are the odds that that was accurate? And by people living with him, contemporaries of him, which is to say it's just a made-up story. Mormonism works by way of private revelation as well. Moroni comes to Joseph Smith. And I'm not saying these facts are related, but Joseph Smith was stoned constantly on opioids, so you connect dots there if you want. But again, private revelation, not based upon a falsifiable historical event. Now, the atheists may claim that we are infantile and unintellectual, and this is often true, and praise the Lord. In a sense, it's true of all of us, as Jesus says. We thank the Father that he saves infants. And they can say that our practices seem strange. They had better seem strange to them. They're the sons and daughters of the devil. They shouldn't be able to make sense of what we do. But what they cannot dismiss is Christ crucified and risen on the third day. And in fact, they don't. As I referenced, I think it was a couple weeks ago, they have this theory of mass psychosis or mass hypnosis, that all the disciples of Jesus came to the same false conclusion by some sort of mass delusion and therefore were willing to die for something that wasn't true, but that they believed to be true. Now, the fact that this cockamamie theory exists in the first place is the result of the irrefutable truth of the resurrection. You may have noticed that atheists don't actually care to seek explanations for many of the things that we believe. You ever heard some crazy theory explaining the talking donkey or the sun standing still in the sky? No, you just hear mockery and derision from them. But when it comes to the resurrection, they have to come up with an explanation, even if that explanation is absolutely absurd, because that's the best they've got. There are theories that seek to disprove the resurrection are idiotic, but they are. And they are because this they cannot laugh away. So God forbid we would ever let them claim that the resurrection has been debunked and thus cease to emphasize it. And this touches upon an issue of apologetics, which Pastor Dan raised as a subject earlier. There is a common philosophy in this discipline that basically states that we should seek novel arguments, that we shouldn't use the same old common fare. We want to find something new, something different. Well, this fails on multiple levels. First of all, after two millennia, I assure you all we've got left here are common arguments. You're not that creative, and if you are, you're a heretic anyhow. Secondly, the issue with a defense of the gospel is not how commonplace that argument may be. It's whether or not the argument's actually been successfully objected to or rebutted. And when it comes to the resurrection, it certainly has not. And when it comes to anything else that Scripture teaches, it certainly has not. But this, of all things, again, has no natural explanation. This thing is dead in its tracks if Christ is still dead. It rises up in his own generation. That cannot happen if the claim of supernatural resurrection is not true. Christ risen, as I said, is our right hook. And I actually don't think that that's even the best analogy. I think Christ risen is our nuclear option. And we hope that nuclear armed countries and literal nuclear armament never push that button. But when it comes to us, we should be pushing it in every single conversation that we have with unbelievers. If it were possible to push that button so much that it could get broken, that the plastic could crack and spring would pop out the side, that's how much we should be pushing this button. It is theological napalm. There is no explanation for the rise of Christianity other than a risen Christ. Point number three, preaching extols Christ and him crucified. Now, Peter does this in multiple ways, and we're going to work through these in the order that they occur in this sermon. And again, this is the soul of Christian preaching. Peter does this first through Christ's miracles. Verse 22 again, men of Israel, listen to these words. Jesus the Nazarene, a man attested to you by God with miracles and wonders and signs which God performed through him in your midst, just as you yourselves know. Why do you suppose the claim of Christ's resurrection was so incredibly credible for these 3,000? Was it merely a matter of them accepting the testimony of Peter and company? No. It was the fact that they had seen Jesus do things that no other man could do. So the apostles did not have to prove that he was divinely empowered to perform miracles. They just had to prove that he'd performed this miracle, which is not so great a leap. Now, we live in an age that considers itself enlightened and therefore scoffs at the supernatural. But you must not on this basis be deterred from proclaiming supernatural claims. Now, we as Christians may or may not be intellectuals, but whatever God has given us in this area, we certainly do not worship the God of intellectualism. The God of intellectualism casts out all things supernatural, or at least dismisses their occurrence, and instead focuses on matters that the godless deem to be more reasonable. Again, the greatest supernatural revelation of Christ's true nature is the resurrection, which is certainly supernatural. And it is so well attested to historically that the refutations of it require more faith than the acceptance of the actual event. So if Christ was raised, what other miracles that the Bible claims he performed are unreasonable? In fact, what other claims can the Bible make, period, that is unreasonable? All of a sudden, that talking donkey doesn't sound so crazy. If he can control life itself, he can certainly do that. Now, bear in mind that these so-called intellectuals also believe that the universe is the product of spontaneous cosmic flatulating, and that gender, and now sex as well, can be magically changed through a verbal incantation. A man merely has to say, I can be a woman, I can be a woman, I can be a woman, and it is so. So don't acquiesce to fake intellectuals in opposition to God. Furthermore, Christ's miracles matter because they reveal his nature as God, as well as his character as the God-man. Why did Jesus perform his miracles? To glorify the Father, absolutely. To open the minds of the elect so that they were able to discern that he in fact was the Messiah. Oh, that's absolutely true as well. Are those the only reasons? That he fed thousands? That he healed the masses? No, it was because he was good. It was because he loved them. It was because he had genuine compassion upon them. People need to know this. And they know this largely through his supernatural workings. Next, Peter raises Christ's overwhelming nature and essence. Now, overwhelming is a term that's often abused. Seldom, when we use this term, have we been truly taken beyond the pale, or had our senses saturated to the point where we can bear no more. In truth, there isn't a lot in life that can really bring us to the brink this way. There's even less that should. Often when we are overwhelmed by anxieties that are sinful. But Christ is actually rightly overwhelming. So part of the preacher's job is to reveal this to his hearers. And Peter does this here with the statements, for example, that it was impossible for him to be held in death's power. And he has been exalted to the right hand of God. And his enemies are his footstool. However, the apostles in general established Christ's immense scale in many ways. Creation is one of those. I referenced several examples of that earlier. Salvation, obviously. Christ's status as the eternal Son. His stretching over all the history of man and in the time when history was not, because time was not. That is certainly overwhelming. They do this by establishing his status as the perfect man, which is far beyond my fathoming. And they do this by revealing his status as the ultimate sovereign, as Peter does in this sermon as well. I step back for a moment. Psalm 49 speaks of man in his pomp, man in his pride, man in his arrogance. It says this, starting in verse 5, and we'll skim and explain as we go. Why should I fear in days of adversity when the iniquity of my foes surround me? Even those who trust in their wealth and boast in the abundance of their riches. No man can by any means redeem his brother or give to God a ransom for him. For the redemption of his soul is costly, and he should cease trying forever, that he should live on eternally, that he should not undergo decay. As revealed by the psalmist in that psalm, every man without fail believes that he is his own Savior in many different respects, and he abides in this lie. This is who the preacher is preaching to, and this is what he must address. Continuing on, starting again in verse 10, for he sees that even wise men die, the stupid and the senseless alike perish and leave their wealth to others, but their inner thought is that their houses are forever and their dwelling places to all generations. They have called their lands after their own names, but man in his pomp will not endure. He is like the beasts that perish. This is the way of those who are foolish and of those after them who approve their words. In other words, man has no sense of his own transience, that he is here today and gone tomorrow. He lacks any awareness that tomorrow is not guaranteed and that forever belongs to God alone. This is who the preacher is preaching to. This is what he must address. And by the way, again, I'm not talking about me only. I'm talking about you. Picking up again in verse 18, though while he lives, he congratulates himself, and though men praise you when you do well for yourself, he shall go to the generation of his fathers. They will never see the light. Man in his pomp, yet without understanding, is like the beasts that perish. Today they self-adulate, well, tomorrow they die. This is who the preacher is preaching to, and this is what he must address. But how can the preacher address this? How can the preacher take this miniature man or woman who believes that they are full size and relieve them of this delusion? You overwhelm them with the scale, the beauty, the wonder, the majesty, the eternality, the infinite love, and the infinite wrath of King Jesus. That's how. This is our responsibility as Christians, period. And we offer this grace to the lost and to the found alike. And the former category obviously has never known the magnificence of Christ, and so we make it known to them. But the latter category is far too quick to forget, aren't we? So with our words, with each other and with the lost, we put our fingers on the scale, and we press them back down to where they belong, while simultaneously raising Christ in their minds back to where he belongs. The image bearers of God are the shadows, nothing more. Christ is the light. It is our blessed responsibility to show each other and the world this great truth, to the salvation of sinners and the sanctification of saints, to the glory of God. And as I was back there, I'm often in prayer while you all are singing and engaging in the other aspects of corporate worship. But I listened to the words of one of the hymns that was chosen for this afternoon. It certainly accomplishes this. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me to life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer. But this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. That is when a soul is overwhelmed, when they have no answer. And that is the purpose of preaching, to reveal a God to them who cannot be known, a Christ who is vast. Next, Peter raises the victory of the cross. Look to verse 31 again to start. David looked ahead and spoke of the resurrection of the Christ, that he was neither abandoned to Hades nor did his flesh suffer decay. This Jesus God raised up again, to which we are all witnesses. Therefore, having been exalted to the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured forth this which you both see and hear. For it was not David who ascended into heaven, but he himself says, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. Now when they heard this, they were pierced to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brethren, what shall we do? Peter said to them, repent and each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, for the promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call to himself. Let me give you my own very brief synopsis of that. It is that Jesus allowed you to kill him physically as a means of him killing you spiritually, and as you die through him by repentance and faith, his life will be born in you by the power of the cross. Now, the symbol of the cross has been stolen by the Roman Catholics, but the message of the cross is ours forever and always. We preach Christ crucified as an invitation for sinners to share in his death and be forgiven by it also. Now, I'm about to give you an illustration here, and I promise there's a point, but it won't be revealed immediately, so bear with me. Let me ask you, have you ever known some haughty somebody who had a particular axe to grind respecting a particular issue, and the second that somebody in their presence even casually raises that issue, they pounce all over them? This is their pet thing. How often with these people, they have some esoteric knowledge of this subject or another, and they don't know a lot about a lot of other things, so because this is their thing, their pride won't allow even the mention of this to go on without them vomiting everything that they know about it all over the poor soul that didn't know better than to raise it. We've all been in that situation, and we have all lamented the fact that we were and wanted to escape that very lengthy conversation that preceded a benign statement. Now, in terms of general conversation, you have nothing to learn from this person. Do not be like them. But with respect to this issue, there is something to learn from them. When it comes to Christ and him crucified, every path to this subject should be taken. And where none exists, make one. And whatever else we may be, we are preachers of the cross. Be it in the town square, be it in a quiet corner, everywhere, we preach Christ, and there is no preaching Christ without preaching his crucifixion. This is how, according to verse 21, it shall be that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. That is the means of their salvation. And so if this is not in our message, if it is not in fact the thrust of it, then what the heck are we talking about? And why are we talking at all? Next, Peter raises Christ's resurrection. Now, because we've already treated this subject at length, I'll only say here that the victory of the cross is not a victory without the resurrection. Mystics emphasize the death of Christ at the expense of his resurrection. We don't do that. Next, he raises Christ as Savior. And Christ as Savior, by the way, means Christ as Savior. It does not mean Jesus plus some church. It does not mean Jesus plus the right lineage. That is clear enough to the people who are hearing this, who are sons of David and being spoken to as wicked. It is not Jesus plus the quality of your abstention from sin. You cannot be sinless enough to gain merit with God, because God is holy, 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 and you without him are wicked, 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 even if you control the external expression of your sin. You cannot purge yourself from that which rots your own soul, and God sees that. It's also not Jesus plus the power of your believing. And this last point is one that is missed by many. Let me use this example. It wasn't the amount of blood on the doorpost that saved from the angel of death, was it? No, it was the presence of it. And it was not the degree of faith present in the one who applied the blood, but the presence of the blood that saved by the promise of God. Peter absolutely preaches that what saves is the object of faith and not faith itself, because Peter preaches within the greater framework of biblical theology, which again, as referenced earlier, is you must be born again. Faith is a gift. It is not by the power of your believing that you are saved. It is not that you have believed well enough. You cannot believe well enough. And our believing is subject to failure often and in many ways. Nor, in fact, are we saved by grace as some separate issue. To say that grace saves is to, in a different way, say once more that Christ saves. It is Christ who is saving. He alone. Not the power of your believing, not some force that is understood to you to be some nebulous something. Christ alone saves. Next, Peter raises Christ's eternal dominion. Verses 32 through 35. This Jesus God raised up again, to which we are all witnesses. Therefore, having been exalted to the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured forth this which you both see and hear. For it was not David who ascended into heaven, but he himself says, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. Now, first off, we need to understand that reference to the Lord's right hand. This is not a place, as some assume. It is a position of power. And to give someone a seat at a ruler's right hand was to confer upon them the full power of that ruler's throne. And Paul expounds upon this with great clarity. Ephesians 1:18 through 23. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened, so that you will know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the surpassing greatness of his power toward us who believe. These are in accordance with the working of the strength of his might, which he brought about in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above how much rule? All rule. And how much authority? All authority. And all power and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. And he put all things in subjection under his feet and gave him as head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. So according to Peter and Paul, there's a great narrative being written with many chapters. Church age of the last days, according to verse 17, is one of those chapters. Second coming is going to be another one. There will be innumerable subplots in this story as well. But brother or sister Christian, there isn't going to be so much as a single point of punctuation on any page of this narrative that King Jesus didn't himself directly dictate. And in fact, the supreme sovereign control of Christ over all things is also demonstrated in that this is the fulfillment of a promise that he may well have made in the hearing of some of these Jews, or at least with their knowledge of it. Less than 2 months prior to the events that we are now studying, in Luke 22, you have circumstances that would culminate in a statement of profound future dominance by our Lord himself. Luke 22, starting in verse 47 and skimming. Behold, a crowd came, and the one called Judas, one of the 12, was preceding them, and he approached Jesus to kiss him. But Jesus said to him, Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss? When those who were around him saw that what was going to happen, they said, Lord, shall we strike with the sword? And one of them, that would be Peter, struck the slave of the high priest and cut off his right ear. But Jesus answered and said, stop! No more of this. And he touched his ear and healed him. Then Jesus said to the chief priests and officers of the temple and elders who had come against him, have you come out with swords and clubs, as you would against a robber? While I was with you daily in the temple, you did not lay hands on me, but this hour and the power of darkness are yours. Having arrested him, they led him away and brought him to the house of the high priest. Now the men who were holding Jesus in custody were mocking him and beating him, and they blindfolded him and were asking him, saying, prophesy, who is the one who hit you? And they were saying many other things against him, blaspheming. When it was day, the council of elders of the people assembled, both chief priests and scribes, and they led him away to their council chamber, saying, if you are the Christ, tell us. But he said to them, if I tell you, you will not believe, and if I ask a question, you will not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the power of God. And they all said, are you the Son of God then? And he said to them, yes, I am. heard it then from Jesus, and now they are hearing it again from the mouth of Peter. This time, not concerning a Jesus condemned to die, but concerning a Jesus for whom it was impossible to remain held in death's power. And so not only must we communicate that Jesus is risen, you need to be telling people how high. He wasn't just risen from that grave to walk amongst us. He was risen from that grave all the way to the right hand of the Father, holding the greatest seat of power and authority in all the universe. And finally, Peter speaks of Christ's holiness. Now, as we begin to examine this last issue, I want you to remember a couple things. First of all, what we have in Acts 2 is not Peter's sermon. It is a brief excerpt from Peter's sermon. And he acknowledges that, Luke does, in his own writings. And he kept on testifying with many other words. And so we don't have the totality of what Peter preached on any issue, including holiness, but we may rightly assume that much more was said. Second, Peter, unlike Paul at the Areopagus, is speaking to listeners that all knew that God was holy. Nevertheless, Peter still preaches. In verse 38, repent and each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For whom is repentance needed? For the righteous? The righteous have no need of repentance because they are righteous. So repentance then is for the wicked. And thus, verse 40, with many other words, he solemnly testified and kept on exhorting them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. Why must they be saved from this perverse generation if, in fact, they are not a part of it? Oh, they need to be saved from it because they are a part of it. And the wickedness of man is all relative to the holiness of God, the perfection of Jesus. And summation of this last point, and really the entirety of this message, let me quote to you a childhood hymn of mine, and I assume many of yours as well. I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story because I know 'tis true. It satisfies my longings as nothing else can do. I love to tell the story, 'twill be my theme in glory, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story, for those who know it best seem hungering and thirsting to hear it like the rest. And when in scenes of glory I sing the new, new song, 'twill be the old, old story that I have loved so long. I love to tell the story, 'twill be my theme in glory. I love to tell the story of Jesus and his love. Brother and sister, if the Christian life were one long song with many verses and only one chorus, it is very clear that that singular chorus would be Christ and him crucified, a gift for sinners testifying of eternal love. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time. I pray that your people receive this with gladness. I pray that if there are those here who are not numbered amongst us, they would receive it with gladness as well and turn and be converted even today. We praise you and we thank you for these things. In Jesus' name, amen.